One of the most important investigations the program has mounted. Dramatic new evidence on the killing of policewoman Yvonne Fletcher in London's St. James's Square. Tonight, how the official version of the events behind her murder cannot be true. How she cannot have been shot from the Libyan Embassy. But if not, then how? In a major two-part investigation, dispatches reporter Joe Laban pieces together the full sinister truth behind her death. He will meet the man who knows just why she was killed, and the man who brought the gun into this country. And he will ask exactly who was in the know. That's Dispatches, on the disturbing evidence we must confront in Murder in St. James's.
St. James's Square, a quiet haven in London's bustling West End. Ignored by office workers on their lunch breaks, a grieving mother visits a little-known memorial, a cherry blossom planted after her daughter, policewoman Yvonne Fletcher, was gunned down outside the Libyan embassy 13 years ago. So far, no one has been charged with her murder, even though it was committed in front of scores of witnesses and two television crews.
Until the whole situation is cleared up, it's not only hurtful to us, but it's hurtful to all the policemen and that who were there at the time, them not knowing what really happened.
So you think it's right that people keep looking into this?
I think it is, until they found out the truth of the situation.
April the 17th, 1984, began with a common sight for Londoners, demonstrators protesting outside the embassy of a hated regime. The focus of their anger, Libya's Colonel Gaddafi, a tyrant who hanged dissenters at home and hunted them down overseas. For the police, it was just part of the daily grind. For the public, a colourful diversion. One constable caught everyone's attention, Yvonne Fletcher, then the shortest police officer in Britain. She seemed relaxed and cheerful.
I'm sure that she was entering into the spirit. She was smiling and laughing. There wasn't any animosity anywhere at that time.
I remember when we came out from the bus, the policewoman was greeting us. It was a beautiful day, a sunny day. And we came down and the policewoman was saying good morning to us and she was smiling.
Soon after the anti-Gaddafi demonstrators arrived, Gaddafi supporters came out of the embassy to shout back at them.
Then it got a bit nasty, everyone was yelling and screaming and being quite horrid. And at that time I noticed that the window on the second floor was being opened by some swarthy Egyptian-type-looking man. Didn't think anything more of it.
No one else realised the significance of the embassy's open windows, least of all the police officers standing directly beneath.
But about 10 minutes after that, some shots were fired.
Some bullets flew over the heads of the demonstrators, hitting an office block across the square.
So the bullets went like this, really, because the first bullet was there, the second was there and there. So they went diagonally.
So bang, bang, bang.
Yes,
like that.
Right. I suppose so, yeah. It was morning and I was in my office, which was on the second floor of up there, yes. And suddenly a bullet came through the double glazed window, hit a column which was opposite me and then ricocheted and hit me on the head.
Where did it hit you?
There.
Tragically, there was no lucky escape for Yvonne Fletcher, standing on the other side of the square.
For me, it was like fireworks. I was taking photographs of the incident. And I looked in the front of me, and I saw the policewoman was coming down very, very slowly.
At the time, it seemed clear what had happened. A camera crew filming the demonstration caught what sounded like the last shot of a burst of automatic gunfire. Yvonne Fletcher was hit, an incident which sent shockwaves round the world. Her colleagues got her to a side street, along with 11 anti-Gaddafi demonstrators, also injured in the hail of bullets. She was taken by ambulance to Westminster Hospital, but died soon after. The bullet which hit her had caused massive damage. Doctors could do nothing to stop the internal bleeding. After a standoff of 10 days, the Libyans were allowed to leave, five at a time. Others had already fled through a back exit. To the dismay of the police, no action would be taken against any of them. Instead, the remaining 22 diplomats and eight others were escorted to Heathrow Airport. 3 weeks later, the jury at the inquest delivered their verdict. Yvonne Fletcher was unlawfully killed by a bullet fired from the first floor of the Libyan embassy. That then is the received wisdom, but members of the intelligence world began to tell us privately that all was not as it seemed. Though this was an apparently routine demonstration, the security services were there in force. None will speak out in public, but their concerns have been passed to former colleagues. One man still in close touch is former member of British Army Intelligence, Colin Wallace.
There's a general feeling of unease that the full truth has never been discovered, and it could be that this was simply a matter of people covering up after the event, maybe to hide the fact that something went wrong. But I think the great difficulty we have is that when something goes dreadfully wrong in the intelligence community, because it is such a closed world, it is virtually impossible for any organization to get at the truth at a later date.
To try to get at the truth, we built a computer model to reconstruct the events of April the 17th, 1984. We reassessed the evidence collected by the police and their forensic experts. We went back to the evidence given before this court at the inquest into Yvonne Fletcher's death. The case was wrapped up quickly by the coroner, Paul Knapman, but alarming inconsistencies were not addressed. We wanted to compare what the inquest heard with the original post-mortem report, but despite a request from Yvonne Fletcher's mother, Dr. Knapman refused to release it. Professor Bernard Knight did the crucial forensic work on the victims of Fred and Rosemary West. With 40 years' experience, he's one of Britain's leading pathologists.
Well, the coroner's act and the coroner's rules say that interested parties are entitled to a copy of the post-mortem report on application to the coroner and payment of a fee.
So the mother of a victim would class, presumably, as an interested party?
I would thought so.
We wrote again to the coroner, reminding him of his obligations. He relented and released the post-mortem report. This was highly revealing. It showed the pathologist, Dr. Ian West, had changed drastically his analysis of what he thought had happened. There were big differences between what he wrote in the post-mortem report and what he said subsequently at the inquest. We took these findings to an expert in gunshot wounds, the former chief consultant surgeon to the British Army in Northern Ireland.
The actual track of the bullet gives the actual body story of what went on, if I can explain. The pathologist's first report found this angle of entry into the back of the deceased at 60 to 70 degrees.
To quote Dr. West's post-mortem report,
the angle of the bullet wound track indicates that she was shot in the back by a person who was situated at a considerably higher level. The track would indicate that she had been shot from the upper floors of an adjacent building.
But the police experts found no evidence of bullets fired from anywhere other than the first floor of the embassy. The angle from the first floor is just 15 degrees. One of the demonstrators had a stomach wound where the bullet had indeed entered at 15 degrees. But that doesn't square with the wounds to Yvonne Fletcher.
The bullet had entered the chest wall, gone down into the liver, at an angle measured as 60 to 70 degrees. That really means that it was fired by someone, as he said in his first report, from the top of a high building. You're talking six, seven, eight floors, depending on how far away from the building the subject is standing. But what happened in this case was that, unfortunately, an attempt was subsequently made to marry the post-mortem findings to the evidential findings reflecting the 15 degrees.
So once the police have said it's probably the first floor of the Libyan embassy, that would be a 15 degree angle, you're sort of working backwards as the pathologist, is that what you're saying?
Well, there is a tendency, I mean, obviously there's this pressure on any pathologist to try and match the evidence.
At the inquest, Dr. West said she must have been turning when she was shot. This, he claimed, would reduce the angle of the bullet wound from 60 degrees to 15. Turning, together with the natural curve of her back, would make it
entirely consistent with a shot fired from the first floor window.
Now, the pathologist placed a lot of emphasis on the fact that Yvonne Fletcher must have been turning when she was shot, and that this would have affected the angle.
I'm not sure that I see how turning affects it. Leaning backwards or leaning forwards would affect it, but turning, to me, means that the horizontal parts of the body stay at the same level, and the body turns on its axis.
He set a great deal of store by this, the pathologist, Dr. Ian West. He suggested that in order to put the gunman in the first floor embassy window, she had to be turning in that direction, from left to right.
Yeah, well, I can't understand that. I can't see how it's relevant.
You can't match an angle of 60 degrees or so to a 15 degree angle. Now, an attempt was made, and that attempt, in my opinion, was quite facile. If Yvonne Fletcher, PC Fletcher, had been turning, that the turning, the mechanism of turning, would somehow reduce the incipient angle to the body. And that's rubbish, because, as you can see, you can turn, you'd have to actually do a Fosbury flop in order to get that angle down to any great degree. And that's impossible to even conceive.
This graphic reconstruction shows just how far back Yvonne Fletcher would have had to lean to get the angle down to 15 degrees. It's an unlikely posture, impossible to achieve without falling over. Bending forwards would have left different internal injuries.
This is a nonsense. When you turn, you normally turn this way. Your chest hardly moves. If it does move at the outer part, the injuries sustained at this part and this angle certainly don't, towards the core, they don't alter at all. The fact is that if you turn, the lumbar spine still remains in roughly the same area. It's a nonsense.
Well, what on earth was he talking about?
He'd have to explain that. I don't know what he's talking about. That evidence, I don't consider valid. At all.
We asked Dr. West to explain his conclusions. First, he cancelled two appointments. Then he declined an interview and refused to even meet us. The second thing that caught Hugh Thomas's attention was the speed of the bullet which killed WPC Fletcher. When it hit her, it was running out of energy.
In this particular instance, the gunshot came through the chest, smashed through the liver, and made a tremendous, considerable amount of damage as it went through, hit the inferior vena cava, which is a large vessel going down in this region here, got reflected off the surface of one of the lumbar vertebrae, and went sideways and backwards at an angle through the rest of the liver and the pancreas, ending up by coming out of the chest wall and going around the elbow, which is held to the side, and plopping out, falling into the cloth. Literally fell out. It was at terminal velocity.
So that means it was slowing down at the
point. It had almost slowed down. Well, it did actually stop. It had actually caused these wounds in its terminal path. It was tumbling. The effect on the liver means it was tumbling even before it actually hit the lumbar spine itself.
A tumbling bullet, like the one that killed Yvonne Fletcher, is usually at the end of the range of the weapon which fired it. For a Sterling submachine gun, the weapon the police thought was fired from the embassy, the range is more than the width of St. James's Square. But Yvonne Fletcher was standing just 30 yards away. Lieutenant Colonel George Stiles, 26 years in the British Army, was one of its leading weapons experts.
I don't think a submachine gun killed the police lady.
Why not?
Because the bullet was going comparatively slowly, and I think from a submachine gun it would have gone that extra bit faster than the wounds that you've described?
Sterling is a submachine gun, and at 30 yards you'd expect the bullet to go almost straight through anybody standing in front of it.
From the description of the wounds, I think if it was a submachine gun, there would have been a little bit more penetration. The bullet wouldn't have tumbled about so much, it would have gone a bit straighter.
The end of the range of a submachine gun certainly isn't 30 yards. And any pathologist faced with this would have raised eyebrows instantly at such a concept.
Surprisingly, this obvious point was not raised at the inquest, either by the pathologist or the police ballistics experts. We took Hugh Thomas to the square. He was struck by the fact that number 5 is one of the smaller buildings.
Do you think Yvonne Fletcher was shot from number 5, from the building behind you?
I would think it's almost impossible that she was shot from number 5, because there's no floor in the building which would give an angle of 60 to 70 degrees or anything close to
it. Now, this is an extraordinary suggestion that you are making. I want you to be quite clear. You do not believe Yvonne Fletcher was shot from that embassy building behind you.
For two reasons. The terminal velocity of 30 yards, which is the distance from me to the building, would be an extraordinary event for a submachine gun bullet. And secondly, the angle of 60 to 70 degrees of entry into the body would be totally inconsistent with an angle of 15 degrees or so coming from that building. There may well have been shots fired from number 5, but you can't say that the bullet that entered her body came from that angle. It's impossible to have that occur.
Barry Howson, one-time choir boy. Today he plays the organ each week at his local church in Sussex. But in the early 80s he was a major arms dealer, selling weapons to Libya. He stayed close to Gaddafi and others in the Libyan regime. At the time of the shooting he was a frequent visitor to the embassy in St James's Square.
They were sold, Sterling. Some machine guns. I saw those. I saw a couple of East German pistols lying around, but they were pretty careful with that stuff. It was locked in a sort of cabinet in the main first floor reception.
So just to be quite clear, you had bigger fish to fry. You were doing bigger arms deals with
direct
the
with Libya.
Back
yes,
in Tripoli.
That's right. Yes. Yes.
And you weren't selling handguns, for example, to the embassy?
No, no.
But other people were?
Oh, yes, yes.
Would the authorities, the British authorities, have known about this?
Well, of course they would.
The Libyans were housed in considerable elegance in their London embassy. Guests at the ambassador's receptions might not have known of the cache of guns and ammunition, but the occupants were waging a campaign of terror in Britain. A month before the shooting, the police anti-terrorist branch warned Libyan exiles to be alert. Two bomb attacks followed in London and Manchester. Questions were asked in Parliament, yet the embassy stayed open.
The Libyan People's Bureau in London would have been a major target for both British and American intelligence operations. This would have involved electronic surveillance, intercepting telephone messages, telex messages, radio messages, the use of microphones to pick up any communication from windows, etc., the planting of microphones and bugs within the building where that's possible, photographing all visitors to the building. The building would have been under surveillance by intelligence officers in adjoining buildings or from vehicles.
Phone calls in and out of the embassy on the ordinary landline. The powers that be in this country knew about it before you did, you know.
So if you were having dealings over the phone with the Libyan embassy,
yes,
they would know about
yes.
it? What, they would come and talk to you about it?
Yes, I've had a couple of occasions when I've been approached and told, would I mind not going ahead with this particular operation.
Barry Howson's suspicions were well-founded. In the weeks before the shooting, the security services stepped up their surveillance. They established an observation post to monitor the Libyans on one of the upper floors of number 3.
They were just pulling tire and smart people. I would say in a region between 25 to 40. So, I mean, this came about spread over 4 or 5 weeks. The explanation I was given was that there was a lot of pilfering going on in the square, and they wanted to try and view different parts of the square from that angle.
But you don't really buy that explanation. You think they were more interested
not
in
now.
Libyans?
Not now. I did at the time.
By April 1984, the Libyan embassy was breaking up into factions, hardline revolutionaries, career diplomats, and others whose loyalty to Gaddafi was suspect. Two of the career diplomats warned the British authorities that trouble was brewing. They tried desperately to get the demonstration stopped, without success.
Everybody knew this was a powder keg. This was waiting to blow up.
But they'd had demonstrations outside before, surely?
Half a dozen people with a couple of white flags.
This was felt to be different?
Yes, definitely. Very, very different.
The paranoia inside the embassy was heightened because the demonstrators weren't just students. The organisers, the National Front for the Salvation of Libya, were financed in part by the CIA. A month after the demonstration, they staged an unsuccessful military coup against Gaddafi. They'd long since infiltrated the embassy and passed on what they knew to the British authorities.
We were very successful in that regard. I mean, it became one time that at least we have one person in the major embassies, Libyan embassies abroad.
Including
and
London?
Sometimes more.
Including London?
Including London. And we have our people in very close circles to Gaddafi himself.
On the day of the demonstration, the police received two separate warnings that there might be a shooting incident. At around 7:30 a.m., the Libyans warned contractors setting out crowd control barriers that they had guns inside and there would be shooting. The police were told this over half an hour before the demonstrators even arrived, but they didn't take the threat seriously. They also ignored the suspicions of a security guard at number 4, who saw packages taken into the embassy which he thought might contain weapons. But these were not the only warnings. We have spoken to members of the intelligence services who tell us that the electronic surveillance had worked. They say MI5 knew the day before that shooting was on the cards.
Members of the intelligence community believe that the security service did receive information from a reliable source and almost certainly from another intelligence agency.
So let's be clear about this. We're talking about MI5 here. We're talking about another intelligence agency. Who is this?
Almost certainly it was an American agency. Whether it was the CIA or one of the other organizations, we don't know. But almost certainly another agency, possibly American, provided information to the security service to the effect that firearms were likely to be used in an incident involving the Libyan People's Bureau.
To piece together just what the authorities knew, dispatches have spoken over many months to well-placed sources in Western intelligence and key Libyan defectors about the events in the square. We've confirmed that the British and American security services were in regular contact with informants inside the embassy. By this time, they could easily decode telecommunications to and from the building. The day before the demonstration, the embassy cabled Libya with three options: do nothing, seize some of the dissidents, or shoot them. This crucial information, which would have saved Yvonne Fletcher's life, was intercepted, but it only got as far as British intelligence. It never reached those in the firing line.
We're talking 1984, the police were very definitely outside the loop because they weren't seen as part of the intelligence picture, simply hadn't been part of the tradition.
In Britain, government and the security services meet in Whitehall at the hugely powerful and top secret Joint Intelligence Committee. Few know its workings intimately. One who does is the former civil servant assigned to it shortly after the shooting.
The police aren't part of the Whitehall village culture. They're not part of the picture. From my own knowledge, you're talking about the stuff we're talking about here, which is intelligence and politics and international politics at that, then the police would certainly have been out of the loop. The tradition was MI6 and intelligence generally, particularly 6, and senior civil service were of a particular class, if you want.
Social class.
Yeah, public school, Oxbridge, etc. And Mr. Plod was somewhat different.
The police received quite specific warnings on the day of the embassy shooting that an incident involving firearms might be taking place, but they didn't take it seriously.
Well, it would make sense, you know, when you have these intercepts coming in and so on at the Cabinet Office, there are then subcommittee meetings to consider the different bits of information that are coming in. Now, the practice is to get all the different civil servants in, and indeed somebody from MI5 or 6 or GCHQ would also be present at some of those meetings to consider the significance or otherwise of the information received. It would make sense sometimes to have the police there, but I don't ever remember the police as such being present at any of those subcommittee meetings.
If there was a system for sharing information with the police, they might have taken the warning seriously.
Undoubtedly.
Amazingly, the police were excluded from the Whitehall village even after one of their officers was shot. Cobra, the Special Cabinet Office Committee to deal with emergencies, met every morning during the crisis, but the police weren't invited until the third day. Sir Kenneth Newman, then Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police, arrived first, but it was too late. The key decisions had already been made. So what exactly had happened inside the intelligence community? Selected journalists were told in unofficial briefings at the time that as messages flew between London and Libya, the crucial intercept got lost somehow in the bureaucratic maze. A seductive theory, but dismissed by insiders.
I think it's unbelievable that an intercept of such importance dealing with a prime target would have been put aside casually or overlooked. The intelligence services, despite the way that sometimes they're projected, are very efficient organizations, and an electronic intercept would have passed through a number of different bodies within a very short period of being received.
If there is a need to do something before morning, then it will be done. Some of the people I worked with were on bleeps. They'd be working up. Cars would be sent to fetch them in. Emergency meetings would be had. All could happen in the middle of the night if it was necessary. Even if you had doubts, then you would wake somebody more senior up so they would carry the can, not you.
It was inconceivable that you could have a succession of cock-ups in a short period of time that would mean a key piece of information would be totally overlooked. I just don't accept that.
The ambassador's office in the Libyan embassy. Libya and Libyan apologists have always claimed there was no shooting at all from here. Our research has found this to be a fantasy. But some of the police evidence is also fanciful. The police believe two Sterling submachine guns were fired from this, the first floor. They found traces of gunfire on the curtains and the sill of this very window. Witnesses disagreed over which window the firing came from, but significantly, no one saw two gunmen. When the forensic experts searched the building, they found no traces of guns fired from any of the higher floors.
The police experts at the time thought there might have been two guns.
Well, like I say, I only heard the one. It sounded the same gun that was firing all the shots.
The police forensic experts told the inquest they were virtually certain that two Sterlings were used, one firing 9 bullets, the other firing 3. They might have revised this opinion if they'd listened to all the available audio evidence. On the day of the shooting, two professional film crews were in the square. The cameraman who filmed this footage missed the shooting completely. The other one switched on late and caught just a single shot.
How did it sound to you?
I would say it sounded like a crackling.
Like a firecracker?
No, it was like, repeat if you know what I mean. Maybe 6 to 12 shots.
The police did have a far better piece of audio evidence, but it was never presented at the inquest. It was recorded on a home video camera hired by a student demonstrator. The police have refused to let us have a copy, though it was given to a BBC programme shown a year after the shooting. We took all the recordings made on the day to a leading audio analyst.
There is something at this point.
He's used as an expert witness in court cases. First off, he analysed the student tape.
Now that excerpt you've just played there is from the Libyan tape, which wasn't admitted as evidence at the inquest. Does that surprise you? The police thought it wasn't very helpful, it wasn't very conclusive.
Well, I'm surprised that it's not helpful because it shows that there's an automatic weapon involved. How many shots we can see if we slow it down.
You can break it down on those peaks.
Yeah, we can break it down. So if we play it slower, which will be like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
What's the gap between them?
It's about a tenth of a second.
So a tenth between each?
Yeah.
Let's just pay those 11 bullets all together.
Okay.
Now, does that sound like one gun to you or two guns?
That sounds like one gun.
You've not much doubt about that?
I'm not much doubt about that.
So the student tape captures only 11 bullets, but the police recovered 12. The 12th bullet was discovered hours after the event, in the ambulance which took Yvonne Fletcher and other gunshot victims to hospital. The police assumed this was the bullet which killed her, but they couldn't be sure. However, there is a way to account for all 12 bullets using the audio evidence available. The key here is the cameraman who switched on just in time to catch a single shot. It's possible that he caught something other than the 11th bullet in the burst from the Stirling. What he recorded may be something quite separate, a 12th bullet, clearly audible, fired from a second weapon.
We've got 11 bullets from the automatic weapon and we seem to have the 12th. There is something at this point. Well, that sounds like a shot, a single shot, that is. So two guns, probably a pistol, but a semi-automatic and a pistol.
Now that is a single shot that you've isolated there, but there seems to be a pause beforehand. How long is that?
There's a pause, there's a cut here. And between that cut and the gunfire is just over 2 seconds, about 2.5 seconds.
So the cameraman is turning over for 2.5 seconds before he picks up that loud bang?
Yes, and the background, there's a car engine running. And and you can hear the car engine running behind that gunshot, so there is no cut at the point of the gunshot.
So this is definitely all of a piece, this is just as it was recorded?
It appears to be all of one piece, yep. We hear the chanting which goes up to... Now the chanting goes up to here and then there is a... and then it changes, so on the video there is a cut and therefore the audio changes. Now at that point you can hear the sound of a car or a van or someone's engine, and that goes on for 2 seconds prior to the bang, and then it continues and the car engine appears to continue through that. Everybody goes into confusion.
So even allowing for the fact that they're recorded on different sources, your analysis suggests that that's something different, a different sort of weapon.
Yes.
Why do you say that?
I say that because if you take the original sound of the single bullet, it's much louder and it just seems more dense, it sounds more dense, whereas the the machine gun is, you know, rat-a-tat-tat, and isn't as loud. And
so this is a denser, louder sound.
It's a denser, louder sound, yes.
Now, given that we've got a two-second gap here, and the gaps between the bullets, the rat-a-tat-tat of the automatic weapon on the student tape are a tenth of a second, can these two be related?
No, they're not related at all. No, no. This is a separate shot entirely.
So what does that tell you? Does it suggest that there is another weapon involved here?
It suggests that there's another weapon. It suggests that there is either a handgun or something, another gun.
Firing a single shot.
This all suggests that whoever fired the bullet which killed WPC Fletcher was able to use the submachine gun fire from the embassy as cover. In the confusion, no one spotted the fatal 12th bullet fired from the top of a building nearby.
Just indicate to me where you think the bullet that killed her could have come from.
If I turn to my right to look behind me like this, it could well have come from the balcony on or from the roof or one of the higher floors of number 3. If, however, I'm standing like this, facing this way, then it could well have come from the building number 8. All we can say is she was shot at 60 to 70 degrees, and both buildings would give a possibility that that could occur.
But number 5, you don't even bring that into your equation?
It couldn't. The one bullet that caused the fatal injury certainly came from the higher building.
Not the embassy?
No.
Way above the square, there's cover for a sniper and possible escape routes. These rooftops, inaccessible from the embassy, were never searched by forensic experts. They can't be ruled out, but the risk of being seen makes an upper floor a safer choice for an assassin. We've spoken to occupants of number 8. In 1984, an American oil company had the top 2 floors, but staff saw nothing suspicious. Across the square at number 3, the top 2 floors were fully occupied by a British company, Distillers. Not so the 6th floor. This empty office space had some very unofficial tenants. The British security services had used it for weeks to watch the Libyans. But on the day of the demonstration, the pattern suddenly changed.
Were they in the building on the day, on April the 17th, 1984?
No, definitely not.
So that floor, number 6, was just vacant?
That floor had been vacant still.
If the killer did fire from number 3, there was a quick and easy escape route. With all eyes focused on the square, he could have been down these back stairs and into a quiet side street in under a minute. But who was he, and who set him up to do it? The trail of Yvonne Fletcher's killer was to take us far from St. James's Square, to a world where sex, drugs and guns are the currency of daily business. In one of Europe's crime capitals, we found ruthless men who know well the name of Yvonne Fletcher. What's more, they know exactly how and why she died. Next week, dispatches will unmask them and lay bare their guilty secret.
That's next Thursday on 4 at the same time, 9 o'clock.
Tonight on Dispatches, dramatic new evidence on one of the country's most puzzling unsolved murders. Who killed policewoman Yvonne Fletcher in London's St. James's Square? Last week, Dispatches demonstrated why the official version of events that she was shot from the Libyan embassy could not be true. Now, to conclude this major two-part investigation, dispatches revealed just who plotted her murder and why. Tonight, reporter Joe Layburn travels to Berlin. In this German underworld, he finds the man who knows how she was killed, and the man who brought the gun into Britain. His report raises the most profound concerns about the intelligence services in Britain and America. And tonight, dispatches join Yvonne's mother in calling for a full inquiry into murder in St. James's.
St. James's Square in London's West End, neat and classical, the very spirit of Englishness. But there are dark secrets here. 13 years ago, a young policewoman was gunned down during a routine demonstration. At the time, the world's media believed she'd been shot by a Libyan diplomat. But nothing was as it seemed that day.
I think the government, the intelligence agencies got together and decided that there was a bigger picture.
Tonight, after a two-year investigation, dispatches unravels a sinister international plot involving ruthless armed gangsters from the Berlin underworld and a shadowy terrorist group supported by the Reagan White House. Tonight, dispatches reveals what had previously been unthinkable, that members of the British and American intelligence services connived in a plot which led to the murder of a British police officer, a fatal sideshow in their secret war against Colonel Gaddafi.
There's still a lot of questions to be answered, and somebody knows something somewhere along the line. What did happen?
But despite a campaign which culminated in the bombing of Tripoli and heavy civilian casualties, the maverick Gaddafi is still in place. Yvonne Fletcher and many others are dead. So far, despite overwhelming evidence, the authorities have refused to ask the right questions about this case, for fear, it seems, of the answers they might find. The official version of events, which the authorities still hold to, is that she died after two Sterling submachine guns were fired from the first floor of the Libyan embassy at number 5, St. James's Square. But from the start, the official line began to unravel. The post-mortem report of Home Office pathologist Dr. Ian West was quite clear. She'd been shot at an angle of 60 to 70 degrees from the upper floors of an adjacent building.
You're talking 6, 7, 8 floors, depending on how far away from the building the subject is standing.
But when forensic experts searched the embassy, they only found traces of gunpowder on the first floor, an angle of just 15 degrees. Come the inquest, Dr. West changed his analysis drastically. He claimed that WPC Fletcher must have been turning, since this would greatly reduce the angle of the bullet wound.
The fact is that if you turn, the lumbar spine still remains in roughly the same area. It's a nonsense.
This graphic shows just how far Yvonne Fletcher would have had to lean back to get the angle down to 15 degrees. It's impossible. In any case, witnesses agree that she was upright when she was shot.
Do you think Yvonne Fletcher was shot from number 5, from the building behind
you? I would think it's almost impossible that she was shot from number 5, because there's no floor in the building which would give an angle of 60 to 70 degrees or anything close to it.
And there are other inconsistencies. The bullet which killed Yvonne Fletcher was running out of energy when it hit her. Her injuries show it was tumbling as it passed through her. But a bullet from a Sterling submachine gun would not start tumbling until it neared the end of its range, greater than the width of the square. Yvonne Fletcher was standing just 30 yards away.
I don't think a submachine gun killed a police lady.
Why not?
Because the bullet was going comparatively slowly.
And at 30 yards, you'd expect the bullet to go almost straight through anybody standing in front of it.
This tape, recorded by a student demonstrator, destroys the official line of two submachine guns, but police withheld it from the inquest. It captures a single burst of 11 shots, but the police recovered 12 bullets. We found the audio signature of the 12th bullet on a tape recorded by one of the TV crews. They switched on late and only caught a separate, isolated shot.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We've got 11 bullets from the automatic weapon and we seem to have the 12th. There is something at this point. Well, that sounds like a shot, a single shot, that is.
The cameraman is turning over for 2.5 seconds before he picks up that loud bang.
Yes.
Can these two be related?
No, they're not related at all. No, no. This is a separate shot entirely.
So what does that tell you? Does it suggest that there is another weapon involved here?
Suggests that there's another weapon. It suggests that there is either a handgun or something, another gun.
Firing a single shot.
Firing a single shot.
One building is tall enough to match the steep angle of the bullet wound, number 3. At the time, the whole 6th floor was vacant, though it was used by the British security services for surveillance.
The explanation I was given for the people that did ask if they could view the square from the 6th floor area was that there was a lot of pilfering going on in the square and they wanted to try and view different parts of the square from that angle.
But you don't really buy that explanation. You think they were more interested
not
in
now.
The Libyans?
Not now. I did at the time.
The evidence points to one disturbing conclusion. Yvonne Fletcher was shot by a second gunman from a different building who was able to use the gunfire from the embassy as cover. But who was he and who set him up to do it? It's now clear that her murder was part of a much bigger picture. The two groups of Libyans who taunted each other that day represented a wider, ongoing battle. For Gaddafi's efforts to eradicate his exiled dissidents did not go unanswered. From early 1984, Libyan diplomats in Europe started fearing for their own lives after a series of tit-for-tat assassinations by a sinister terrorist group called Al-Burkan. The truth behind the murder in St. James's Square is to be found in surprising places, like the seedy underworld of Berlin, where sex, drugs and guns are the currency of nightly life. There are ruthless men here who know well the name of Yvonne Fletcher. What's more, they know exactly how and why she died.
While Gaddafi's hit squads made the headlines for hunting down Libyan dissidents, another private army was at work. In the 80s, criminals from Berlin's underworld knew plenty about Libyan politics. That's because they were the hired hands behind a killing spree of Gaddafi supporters. Their paymasters, rich Libyan exiles, pledged to end Gaddafi's rule. There's compelling evidence that the gun which killed Yvonne Fletcher came from here, just one of many shipped from Berlin all over Europe.
We've tracked down some of the main players who helped Gaddafi's enemies in their bid to usurp him. Many of them fear for their safety now and refuse to talk on camera. Others see their participation in this film as a form of life insurance. The anti-Gaddafi Libyans used them in part as gun runners, supplying weapons for assassinations. Their leader was this man, Hilmar Hein. The silencers were fashioned by one of his closest henchmen, Helmut Nagler.
So tell me about these weapons that you remodeled.
I took in parts to see how it works, no? And it was very easy to manufacture such a silencer because it's no big secret, no? how it works.
And who were these weapons for?
Yeah, Hein told me these weapons were for good friends for self-protection.
Why do you need silencers for self-protection?
Yes, that's right. And now I know this pistol were for this Al-Burkan organization in London.
For the anti-Gaddafi Libyans?
Yeah, for the anti-Gaddafi Libyans.
Nagler worked closely with this man, Manfred Meyer. The gang's exploits took in a firebomb attack on Libya's embassy in Bonn, but always their stock in trade was guns.
Also überwiegend waren es nur Weiler PDK. Da war noch Berettas. Da ging ja, die Waffen gingen ja kreuz und quer. Da hat der General, habe ich selber nicht mal durchgeblickt, wo, was, welche Waffen hinkamen und so. Aber überwiegend Weiler PDK.
Und waren 9mm Pistolen auch dabei?
Wir hatten noch 9mm. Die Schalltemper waren, das waren quasi Messingröhren, da kamen Leder- und Aluminiumscheiben immer rein. Die wurden dann justiert für das eigentliche Projektil. Und unten kam dann ein gedrehtes Metall rein mit Innengewinde und das wurde dann da aufgeschraubt. Die Dinger haben wunderbar funktioniert.
The man paying for their deadly work, Hilmar Hein, was in public the boss of a prominent Berlin construction company. In private, he helped run a terrorist organization, not for ideological reasons, but for profit.
Well, I would say he is megalomaniac, selfish, greedy, trying to prevail in every situation.
Is he dangerous?
Very dangerous. His honesty and credibility is not worth a rush. He brings the people in a certain dependence to him. When he is promising things he never kept, he's a coward, delegating rubbish work to these stooges to keep his own hands clean.
Ich meine, Hein war reich zu diesem Zeitpunkt, sehr reich, ja. Der wusste selber nicht, wie viele Millionen er hatte. Aber es ging um die Macht. Er wollte die Welt verbessern. Ja.
Hein first came into contact with wealthy opponents of the Gaddafi regime through business dealings with this man, Rajeb Zatut. An internal document from the German police said he should be seen as a leading member of the anti-Gaddafi terrorist group Al-Burqan. Al-Burqan, which means the volcano, claimed responsibility for a number of fatal attacks on Libyan diplomats. Many of the murder weapons were traced back to Berlin.
They would kill these two people, one in Vienna and one in Rome. These were Libyan diplomats. And the weapons for this killing came from Hein, or he has organized this for this anti-Gaddafi group.
For Al-Burqan?
For Al-Burqan.
Und was für Leute sind Al-Burqan? Sind sie zu fürchten?
Ich habe, also, wenn ich so rechne, wir hatten uns 12, 13 Tote an. Ich weiß nicht, ob das zu fürchten ist, aber das ist, ich meine, also, zu unterschätzen sind sie nicht. Fürchten, fürchten. Tod ist tot, ja.
But always at the top of the agenda was the ultimate prize, Colonel Gaddafi. In early 1984, another colonel, Oliver North, also had Gaddafi in his sights. As part of President Reagan's unofficial foreign policy, North planned for teams of foreign nationals backed by the CIA to neutralize terrorists opposed to America. Al-Burqan enjoyed just such CIA support. Significantly, Hilmar Hein claims to have met Colonel North in Bangkok during Easter 1983.
Al-Burqan commissioned Hein to organize weapons, even groups and an organization to kill Gaddafi.
They actually wanted to kill Gaddafi?
Yeah.
And who put the money up for that?
This money came from the organization in $30 million.
Sollte der CIA an Hein, also an Satu, 100 Millionen quasi, umgerechnet 100 Millionen Mark, aufgerufen haben, diese zur Unterstützung hatten.
Und das können Sie mit Sicherheit sagen?
Ja, das hat mir ja Hein selber gesagt.
One plan they floated was to recruit mercenaries through contacts in Marseille and get them into Libya posing as workers for Hein's scaffolding company. But despite the huge bounty, the Germans called it off as a suicide mission. Al-Burqan, meanwhile, wanted a training center for their guerrillas. Hein found them this building on a Berlin industrial estate. Other Al-Burqan forces were trained in the USA.
Geplant war ja, dass hier quasi im Keller die Terroristen oder dann die Leute, die dann die Söldner, die dann in Tripolis den eigentlichen Sturz oder den Putsch damit unterstützen sollten, dass sie hier ausgebildet werden sollten. Und da hatte ich dann hier einen Schießplatz. Ein Schießstand eingerichtet.
Oh, hier in diesem Gebäude?
Ja, hier drinnen, ja. Hier kommt man rein und dann links unten ist der Keller. Aber ein richtig großer Industriekeller. Ja.
Number 32 Klicksstrasse, one of Heinz's workshops in West Berlin. It was here that they took apart a distinctive gold-coloured Mercedes, number plate BNY604. Three guns were secreted in the sump. Together with handmade silencers, they were destined for Alba Khan in London.
These pistols were carried to London by car. And this was one of the adventurous stories. These weapons were in this car I brought, or I drove to London.
So you drove the car?
Yeah, I drove the car.
On February the 28th, 1984, Nagler steered the Mercedes with its secret lethal cargo past the watchful eyes of East German border guards, then onto the coast for the ferry to Britain. His ticket shows he stayed in cabin 307 on C deck. This was just one of many such trips made by the Hein gang. The crossing was uneventful, but when Nagler reached the other side, there was a hitch. British customs were suspicious of the Mercedes.
At the border in England, by the custom, they have investigated this car very, very thoroughly, and they have removed the panels from the doors, the panels from the luggage room, and they investigated in the engine compartments, but they didn't find anything. But they have forgotten to get under. They forgot to look under the car. And so I drove this car directly to London. I drove directly to London Hotel Lancaster, where Satou was already waiting for me.
So you met Satou?
Yes, I met Satou, and I drove this car to a parking lot, and then went with Satou in his hotel room.
So the weapons definitely went from Berlin to Satou?
Definitely from Berlin to Satou.
And did he pay for them?
He paid to Hein.
He didn't pay the money to you?
He didn't pay the money to
me. But you know he got those weapons?
Right. Definitely.
And who else was there from Alba Khan? Was it just Satou?
Just Satou.
Just Satou.
Just Satou.
Satou was the main man, as far as you were concerned.
Satou was the main man, and Satou was the only man I got in touch, and I met in Berlin, and I spoke to him in London.
And what sort of man was Satou?
He was a normal man, and as far as I could see, he was a real friend to Hein. Hein told me he can rely on him and he trusts him.
But as far as you're concerned, he was the man behind Alba Khan and he was the man who was behind these killings.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely right.
By the day of the demonstration, 6 weeks after Nagler brought the guns to London, the anti-Gaddafi Libyans believed they were ready to mount a coup in Libya. But how to take world opinion with them? They felt they needed an inflammatory incident which could be blamed on Gaddafi, even if it meant sacrificing their own supporters.
Ich meine, da waren vorher auch andere Varianten im Umlauf, dass eine Handgranate explodieren soll, ein richtiges Blutbad. Ich meine, es wurde viel erzählt.
Another member of the German gang told us privately it was decided 2 months before the demonstration that a British police officer would be targeted. Killed in such a way that the incident could be pinned on Gaddafi. In the Reagan White House, Alba Khan's supporters were growing impatient. Libya's upstart leader had long seemed the perfect opponent for the president's so-called war on terrorism. Gaddafi also had vast reserves of high-quality oil. For commercial and ideological reasons, the Americans were desperate to unseat him and started calling for preemptive strikes. But countries like Britain took a more pragmatic view.
There were many in the British Foreign Office whose eyes would simply glaze over whenever we would come and brief them on the alleged Libyan terrorist threat. And certainly in the case of Gaddafi, the Europeans consistently wanted to do business with Libya, so why alienate the, you know, this opportunity just because those crazy cowboys in Washington thought Gaddafi was promoting a little terrorism.
But as images of Yvonne Fletcher's murder were beamed around the world, attitudes changed. It was to be a turning point, triggering international sanctions and isolation for Gaddafi. The only mystery, why had Gaddafi done it when his opponents were the only ones to benefit? In Berlin, Hilmar Hein was preparing for the takeover of Libya. The leaders of al-Burkhan had promised him lucrative contracts to rebuild the country's capital, as well as valuable import concessions. On the day of Yvonne Fletcher's murder, Manfred Meyer was in Berlin too. He went round to see his boss, Hilmar Hein.
Es hieß ab bloß, der Polizist ging aus dem Haus oder so. Er hatte erst mal gejubelt, er hat eigentlich immer gejubelt. Ja. Er war auch euphorisch, weil er sagte, meine Sachen packen, nächste Woche sind wir unten in Libyen.
Und Sie sind der Meinung, dass die Mordwaffe aus hier, aus Berlin geliefert worden ist?
Damals, wir haben es ganz offen darüber gesprochen, dass es unsere Waffe war und ja, das ist unser Ding. So haben wir gesprochen damals. Ja, wir haben da nicht so gesessen, haben da so drumherum, man, unsere Waffe und hat geklappt, gut.
Das ist sehr wichtig, was Sie sagen. Ja. Sie können das mit Sicherheit sagen.
Das kann ich mit Sicherheit sagen, ja.
The world was outraged by the shooting. As planned, Colonel Gaddafi was blamed. But the weapons the Hein gang had smuggled into London were still there, and 4 months later, they were to be used again. Bickenhall Mansions, just off Baker Street. A Libyan businessman was lured to a flat here, where he was shot in the back of the head. Ali El-Jahour's body was left in the bath, along with a Walter PPK handgun. The police suspected that the flat had been rented by Rajab Zatut of al-Burkhan. They traced the gun, identification number 176979, back to Berlin and the Hein gang.
Es gab es eindeutige Belege dafür, dass zum Beispiel eine Waffe ihren Weg direkt von Berlin nach London nahm und auch in London nachher Verwendung fand bei einer Straftat, nämlich bei der Tötung eines Libyers.
Und das können Sie feststellen?
Das ließ sich deswegen feststellen, weil der Waffenlieferant ein Waffenliebhaber war, der seine Waffe sehr gut identifizieren konnte und auch in der Lage war, die Waffennummer zu benennen. Und das fand sich dann bestätigt durch den Fund in London bei der Tat zum Nachteil des Giauer, glaube ich, Sir Giauer.
Meyer became the key prosecution witness in a case which heard of al-Burkhan's activities all over Europe. He told the German police, not only did he know about El-Jahour's murder weapon, he also knew about the gun which killed Yvonne Fletcher.
Und Sie sind jetzt der Meinung, dass die Polizistin Yvonne Fletcher von einer dieser Waffen erschossen worden war?
Nenne ich jetzt der Meinung war ich schon immer. Also das hatte ich auch beim BKA gesagt oder beim BND, wo ich ein halbes Jahr zur Vernehmung war. Ja, das hatte ich von Anfang an.
But while Manfred Meyer was telling his secrets, other shadowy figures were covering up. They knew that were light to be cast on their role in this tragedy, it would destroy the already tarnished reputations of the British and American intelligence agencies, probably forever. From the start, mystery surrounded the murder of Ali El-Jahour, the Libyan businessman killed 4 months after Yvonne Fletcher. The inquest was handled by the same team who investigated her death, coroner Paul Knapman and pathologist Ian West. Unusually, part of the key evidence was heard in private.
And I can only believe that that had to do with Mr. Jahour's activities. He was quite adamant in protesting his innocence because he felt that he'd been assisting the British authorities for some time in Libya. He had been providing them with what he considered to be intelligence.
So he'd been working for British intelligence, he said?
So he said. That's correct.
Did you find that plausible?
I think that in the circumstances it probably was quite plausible, yes.
At the time of his death, he was charged with involvement in these bomb attacks on anti-Gaddafi dissidents. On the face of it, this would seem to make him a Gaddafi supporter. But our investigations reveal that El-Jahour was actually a member of al-Burkhan, the anti-Gaddafi terrorist group.
Who was officially blamed for these bombs?
The pro-Libyan government, the Gaddafi faction, was blamed for the bombings.
But in hindsight, you suspect it may have been otherwise, do you?
I think it could well have been otherwise, yes.
Remarkably, given the serious charges, conspiracy to cause explosions, El-Jahour was given bail, but from the moment he was released, he told his lawyer he thought he was a dead man.
He felt that whatever happened, that he was really of no longer of any use to any of the people for whom he'd previously been working, whether it was the pro-Gaddafi faction, the anti-Gaddafi faction, or any other agencies he may have been working for. His useful life had come to a grinding halt, effectively.
Since the murders of Yvonne Fletcher and Ali El-Jahour, MI5 and MI6 have moved to expensively furnished new buildings. Theirs is a daily life of secret agendas, a wilderness of mirrors, where little is as it seems. In this world where no one is ever held publicly accountable, it's easy for intelligence officers to lose any sense of morality. Winning is all that matters, and the human cost does not come into the equation. Dispatches have spoken to intelligence officers on both sides of the Atlantic who tell us that MI5 knew the day before Yvonne Fletcher's death that shooting was on the cards.
Members of the intelligence community believe that the security service did receive information from a reliable source and almost certainly from another intelligence agency.
So let's be clear about this. We're talking about MI5 here. We're talking about another intelligence agency. Who is this?
But almost certainly it was an American agency, whether it was the CIA or one of the other organizations, we don't know, but almost certainly another agency, possibly American, provided information to the security service to the effect that firearms were likely to be used in an incident involving the Libyan People's Bureau.
We've confirmed that the British and American security services were in regular contact with informants inside the embassy. Also at this time, they could easily decode telecommunications to and from the building. The day before the demonstration, the embassy cabled Libya with three options: do nothing, seize some of the dissidents, or shoot them. This crucial information, which would have saved Yvonne Fletcher's life, was intercepted, but it only got as far as British intelligence. It never reached those in the firing line. Selected journalists were told in unofficial briefings at the time that as messages flew between London and Libya, the crucial intercept got lost somehow in the bureaucratic maze. A seductive theory, but dismissed by insiders.
I think it's unbelievable that an intercept of such importance dealing with a prime target would have been put aside casually or overlooked. The intelligence services, despite the way that sometimes they're projected, are very efficient organizations. And an electronic intercept would have passed through a number of different bodies within a very short period of that message being received.
If there is a need to do something before morning, then it will be done. Some of the people I worked with were on bleeps. They'd be woken up, rung up, cars would be sent to fetch them in, brought in, emergency meetings would be had. All could happen in the middle of the night if it was necessary. Even if you had doubts, then you would wake somebody more senior up so they would carry the can, not you.
So it's inconceivable that you could have a succession of cock-ups in a short period of time that would mean a key piece of information would be totally overlooked. I just don't accept that.
Unsere Nachrichten erschaffen haben. Und da ich begriffen, aha, jetzt los.
Ist es im Ernst?
Jetzt ist es war ernst. Es gab für mich ja kein Zurück mehr. Ja. Und dann wurde auch gesprochen, dann hat er mich auch, um mich zu beruhigen und mich auf Linie zu halten, dann die Version gebracht, dass er eben mit den Leuten davon reden. Ich sag mal, die Namen waren mir damals nicht sehr geläufig, Poindexter Nord war für mich kein Begriff.
Aber Hein hat gesagt, keine Panik, wir sind vom Amerikanen geschützt.
Das waren die Worte von Hein, ja.
But the German mercenaries quickly learned the harsh realities of life with the intelligence services. They were simply expendable. Once in custody, Meyer's reaction was to talk, providing endless details of Albert Kahn's activities, including the killings in London of Ali El-Jahour and Yvonne Fletcher. Three British police officers flew to Berlin to interrogate the Hein gang.
What did they want to know?
Well, just the way the weapons I have brought to London, no? And I have told them the truth, no? That they were brought by car, no? And And
were they very interested?
Yes, they were very interested, ne, to know how. Ne?
Also diese Polizisten aus Scotland Yard, Sie haben auch über den Tod von Yvonne Fletcher gesprochen?
Das war alles ein bisschen, ich meine, ich habe mich mit denen einmal unterhalten, das war an der Kaltstraße, ja. Aber eigentlich nicht, das war 5 Minuten und das war's, ja.
But the police weren't the only people to call on the Berlin public prosecutor. Shortly after the Scotland Yard officers returned to London, he got another visitor from Britain.
Also ein Vertreter der Geheimdienste, könnte man zumuten.
Ich kenne mich in den britischen Strukturen nicht so gut aus, könnte sein.
Das haben Sie zurzeit gedacht, oder?
Ich persönlich habe es vermutet.
In the end, the British authorities did not pursue the German angle. The German police took a different view and charged Meyer, Nagler and Hein with various crimes in support of Alba Khan. All three went to prison. The German authorities wanted to question the Libyan who pulled the strings, Rajib Zatout, now living in the USA. But they too had a lesson to learn. Some people, called assets in the intelligence world, are just too valuable.
Ich hätte ihn gerne selbst befragt, aber er war dann unserem Zugriff entzogen, letztlich in die USA, wohl ausgewichen.
Man spekuliert, dass Herr Zatout von den Amerikanern geschützt wurde. Kann das sein?
Weiß ich nicht.
Aber er ist nicht nach Deutschland gekommen.
Ich weiß nur, er ist nicht nach Deutschland gekommen. Ich weiß nur, dass ich keine Antwort auf mein Rechtshilfersuchen bekommen habe.
And Rajib Zatout was not the only member of the Alba Khan terrorist group to be supported by the Western intelligence agencies. Our investigations have discovered that certain diplomats inside the London embassy were also secret Alba Khan members, in close contact with their British and American minders. After Gaddafi's fall, they would have become members of a new Libyan government, friendly to the West and to Western oil interests.
Mitglieder von Alba Khan waren unerkannt im libyschen Volksbüro in London und die sollten mit dieser Aktion raus, aber so, dass sie in Tripolis nicht aufsehen oder Misstrauen erregen, ja, dann wäre der Putsch gekommen, wenn das so geklappt hätte und dann hätten die da drüben quasi dann die Schlüsselposition besetzt oder hatten dann wohl scheinbar ihre anderen Verschwörer auch wieder, die gibt es ja überall oder, ja.
Und wann sollte der Putsch geschehen?
Das sollte eigentlich unmittelbar danach passieren, ja.
There was one potential hiccup. The public expectation was that the SAS would storm the building and kill the occupants, just like the Iranian embassy siege 4 years earlier. One of the SAS soldiers called to the square was Steve Devereaux.
My main entry point was up here, the top right hand window, just about to see it above the parapet. That was the first entry point. I would have run across the roof, placed the explosive charge on the particular window, blown the window, and then we would have assaulted through the window, four of us. And somebody throwing flashbangs, creating noise and havoc, taking out any targets that were in there. Well, we would have had MP5s, two of us would have had sawn-off shotguns, and pistols.
Would you have expected that some of the Libyans would have had to be killed in this process?
If they were armed, yes.
Were you disappointed when you were stood there?
Absolutely right, yes. We'd psyched ourselves up for almost 10 days, 2 weeks. And to be told that we weren't going to storm it, you know, it really wasn't, it pissed a lot of people off.
There's no doubt in your mind that you would have been able to successfully storm that embassy in the way that the Iranian embassy was stormed?
No problem. Absolutely no problem at all. And we would have done a bloody good job as well.
Instead, the diplomats were sent home. In public, Gaddafi gave them a hero's welcome, but in private, he was fighting for survival. 10 days after their return, he faced a major coup in which members of Alba Khan took part. The French Secret Service and the CIA passed on satellite photographs and communications intercepts, but the rebellion failed after a street battle with the Libyan army. Ultimately, though, the killing of Yvonne Fletcher still served its purpose. 2 years later, American bombers flew from Britain to attack Libya. Other European states refused to let the bombers fly over their territory. Margaret Thatcher was also reluctant to get involved, but she was swayed by just two words, Yvonne Fletcher.
It was certainly a key factor leading to the British government decision to provide support to the raid on Tripoli. Without British support, the raid probably would not have taken place at all. Without British support, you would have had really only a pinprick in terms of a strike against Libya, because you would not have been able to conduct an effective raid.
The intelligence agencies had finally got what they wanted, the chance to assassinate Gaddafi. Despite targeting his compound, they missed. But the Libyans say 160 civilians were killed in the raid.
A senior figure in the Reagan administration told me privately that the death of Yvonne Fletcher was the best thing that could have happened. What do you think he meant by that?
Well, the essence of the political dimension was that it changed the attitude of the British government toward Gaddafi. And it affected many Europeans as well, who suddenly saw that in their midst were diplomatic missions that indeed were housing thugs who were armed with explosives and assault weapons, who undoubtedly were carrying out the types of activities that they did not want to believe these individuals were capable of.
But that's a very cynical attitude to express, isn't it?
It's very cynical. Unfortunately, I think it's very realistic.
Presumably, at the time, you went along with the official line that we had to let the Libyans go because otherwise it would risk the lives of all the British expats who were living in Libya.
That seemed right and decent at the time. And obviously, being a serving soldier then, yes, we saw that. But I always sort of get myself reminded by what Thatcher used to say, and that was we never give in to terrorists. And on this particular day, we did.
And of course, there were still plenty of expats living in Tripoli when it was bombed 2 years later.
Absolutely right, yes.
As a former SAS soldier, what does this tell you about the way the country works?
Well, it works in strange ways, doesn't it? I mean, the security and intelligence agencies are trying to work to a common cause, but in this particular instance, I don't think they work.
The last government said it's hurtful, we shouldn't reopen these wounds. I mean, what would you say to that?
Well, it is hurtful, but until the whole situation is cleared up, it's not only hurtful to us, but it's hurtful to all the policemen and that who were there at the time, them not knowing what really happened.
So you think it's right that people keep looking into this?
I think it is, until they found out the truth of the situation.
What would you say to Mr. Blair and his new government?
I would say, do you think your ministers could look into the case of Yvonne's death and try to find out the real truth, what happened?
Because that's any way your mind can be put at rest.
Yes, definitely.